on the issues of solidarity and social protection and safety net. We must say that it is very difficult to put it in place. There is, it's sometimes conspicuous, seen from the poor countries. They are confronted with so many different European systems, because we talk about one system, but in fact there are many systems. And there is the alternative of the American system, or whatever system they would like to choose. One of the difficulties is there's too many on offer, so they don't make a choice. Secondly, there is a real push, sometimes also from banks and private insurances, to accept a certain type of social security net. Third, you cannot transfer European concepts with our formal economy and our system of taxes and premiums into countries where there is, to a large part, only an informal economy, where there are no taxes or no premiums. So we have to really be in a tailor-made mood, so to say, when we go to those countries. And they must apply ownership. Unfortunately, that ownership is not often available here. There's always an inclination to go beyond safety nets and do other things first as a priority. If we look at civil society organizations, it's a highly topical issue at the moment. On the one hand, we have formulated beautiful policies, and now everybody wants us to implement those policies. I already talked to you about the limited participatory character of our programming activities. People want to see it improved and so on. On the other hand, there is a bit of awkwardness with civil society organizations. First of all, one wants to elaborate the notion. In the old days, we talked about NGOs. Everything what NGOs did was, per definition, good, because it was a private initiative. It must be good. Now we have seen an elaboration of that, also to trade unions, but you have also the discussion about churches, for instance. Many more organizations manifest themselves, and the latest expression of a recognition is that one of our thematic programs is called non-state actors and local authorities. They are also recognized as actors in development right now. Trade unions as such are mentioned here and there in policy notes, but don't have a preferred status or something in the way we deal with civil society organizations. They are one of the civil society organizations recognized, individualized, mentioned by category, but not having a specific position in the allocation of money. We've seen now, under the influence of international activities, that civil society organizations try to re-mobilize themselves in a certain way and reorganize themselves, be active in debates that are central to development at the moment. There is this ACRA agenda leading to the attention for more effectiveness and efficiency, and I have also the pleasure of co-chairing this working party on effectiveness in Paris. We see there the result of this regrouping of civil society organizations. Better Aid plays an important role over there. And we also encourage this role very much. It's a bit difficult to deliver, I must honestly say, both for donors, traditional donors, and for civil society organizations. I also must know that emerging donors are practically absent from the scene, if we talk about donor effectiveness. So we know what to do, I repeat what I said before, but are we going to do it, and how? It's still a bit beating around the bush. One will not go before the other, and we must all make sure that there is a certain equilibrium. I'd like to push the whole discussion in Paris much more to activities on the ground. There are now groupings of intellectuals discussing about clusters and work streams and I don't know what, adding to methodologies and more chapters in the gospel about how we should cooperate. And I think it's high time that we take a few pilot countries and do it there, what we promised. Go for in-country and cross-country division of labor. And the Commission also will push for that in the debate. The Swedish presidency has already taken up the in-country division of labor. The Spanish presidency will take up the cross-country division of labor. Let's see where we go. But I think we've talked so much about it that if we are not successful in 2010 in realizing something, then perhaps we should say that it will not happen, that it's too political, and that we should not waste more time on these kinds of things. But in this whole process, if we move it to the ground, to the countries, that is where the actors on the ground should be involved. So in that respect, any mobilization that could come from these kinds of conferences to local partners, to capacity building of local partners, would be very welcome. It's a difficult process because in the concept of technical assistance, the question has been asked, what did you do over the past 60 years in technical assistance? Whom did you assist? And who is now able to do the work on their own? Or did you temporarily take over the job instead of assisting after that? We also say that we have been active in institution building, and our Court of Auditors have asked us to send us a few photos of the institutions that we have built so that they could visit them and physically touch them and see what was going on. In fact, it is a complaint against the situation and the method in which the technical assistance has been put in place, more donor-driven than demand-driven. So in all this, we try to support also social partners. The support for this conference is one of the expressions of our interest. Sometimes it's direct, sometimes it's indirect. When we do vocational education and training, for instance, that can also be considered in the way it is conceived as a support to a better functioning of labor circumstances. In this case, I must say that we more and more get in problems with the focus on basic education. In donor land, it's basic education and trade. No trade without tradable product, no tradable product without quality, no quality without vocational education. And you see that's a cynical conclusion, that if you focus so much on basic education, that you have created around the world millions of children that now understand that they are marginalized and isolated. Because after that, there's nothing. That's one of the reasons why the Commission wants to move from projects into support for sectors and support for a general budget support for countries so that you can grow out of the individual project mode, as we mentioned this morning also as not very sustainable, and move into the support for sectors. And I think certainly on vocational education and training there should be a